In this book, you weave together stories of ordinary people who've accomplished extraordinary things.
That's exactly right.
What is the one thing you found that all of those ordinary people had in common?
Well, you know, the book, the subtitle is Five Principles for a Life of Breakthroughs and Purpose. And what we were able to uncover through research is wherever transformational change has taken place, these five principles are present. But most importantly, we were able to debunk the myth that many people live with, that it takes some kind of special genius or going to the right school or having the right degree. And that's exciting news because, as you know, Emily, today in the United States, the number of startups are at a 30-year low. Mm-hmm. More companies are dying every day than being formed. The book is really a clarion call and a playbook for anybody who has ideas out there to get on the playing field and take them forward.
So how could we apply some of these principles to
sure.
investing?
Sure.
Or to starting a company?
Sure. Well, you know, one of the principles is called reach beyond your bubble. And the idea there is bring together a diverse set of people with different backgrounds, different perspectives. And what I love about impact investing is it combines the expertise and sort of the rigor of people who've been in the financial world for a long time with those that understand how social impact and social change happens. Because as you know, an impact investment provides both a financial return and a social return. So it's a whole new category of investing. There are $228 billion under investment today, but that number doubled just in the last year. So we see really strong momentum. And you mentioned Mark Andreessen and Bill Gates, but as you know, the marquee names that are coming in, including the funds and some of the big banks that are getting in as well, it's really exciting. I think there's tremendous traction and momentum going forward.
So are you, and the Case Foundation doesn't do impact investing.
No, what we do is we support the field. So mm-hmm. we have, for instance, some resources, the short guide on impact investing. We have a 10-year look back for people who want to see how the movement has developed so far. But I personally do the impact investing.
Have you found that you can actually make money and do good
absolutely.
At the same time?
Yes, I think there's a tremendous amount of research out there to debunk another myth that impact investing is necessarily concessionary. It is not. Wharton has done extensive work. They looked at different asset classes, but particularly private equity, and demonstrated that the impact investments not only performed at market rate or did well in terms of their vintage year, in many cases outperformed.
Mm. So why doesn't the Case Foundation do impact investing?
Well, really the role of the Case Foundation is to build the market and support movements. Mm. And so we have used a blended approach in our philanthropy and impact work where we use the resources of the foundation, we use our personal wealth wherever we can to invest in things to really move the needle.
So what are some trends you see coming in philanthropy and impact investing, let's say over the next 5 years?
Yeah, well, one trend I'm really excited by that I think is happening in both spaces, and that is rigor around measuring impact. You know, for many years, foundations have been out there, investors have been out there trying to have impact, but not really sure when they've actually achieved it. And so I don't know if you saw, but TPG Rise and Bono just mm-hmm. announced, you know, that they're going to really have rigor around measurement and impact. There's another coalition we're supporting, which is called the Impact Measurement Project, which is also trying to make sure that that kind of careful measurement and reporting out is taking place.
Now, Steve Case, your husband, has talked about the rise of the rest,
yes.
the importance of looking outside of
right.
Silicon Valley. Are you seeing those opportunities in impact investing outside of Silicon Valley?
It's super exciting. You know the data, Emily. You know, last year in America, only 2% of venture capital went to firms with a woman-led founder, less than 1% African-American. But the more shocking thing is 75% just went to three places, California, New York, and Massachusetts. So take an entire state like Florida, which is the third largest in the nation. They got less than 2% of venture capital last year. So yeah, rise of the rest is really intended, and Steve has done a great job to go out there and spotlight the great innovation and entrepreneurs that we're seeing between the coasts.
It's interesting that you mentioned this because we just had Keith Raboy on the show who's joining Founders Fund.
I
asked him the very same question, and he thinks that the nucleus is still in Silicon Valley. This is where most of the talent is. This is where it is easiest to scale a huge company because of that.
Yeah, so I think, you know, we really give great respect to Silicon Valley for all that it's been, but it is a part of the solution, not the solution in America. And indeed, if you look at where Fortune 500 companies have been founded, most of them have been founded outside of Silicon Valley, between the coasts. So, you know, understanding our own secret sauce of how we got here, both in terms of doing everything we can to increase the number of startups, getting all the players on the field, because right now about 50% are left on the sidelines between women and people of color. You know, it's really an economic imperative in our nation. It's startups that bring the jobs and provide that economic engine.
Now, I wanted to ask you a question about Amazon HQ too, because Amazon HQ2 is also setting up in your backyard.
It is.
Northern
Alexandria, Virginia. Yeah.
And, you know, there was a lot of development there when AOL was
we started and built our company there, yes.
But Amazon just pulled out of New York because all the protests. We haven't heard much from Northern Virginia.
Virginia's embracing Amazon in
a
really
big way.
And
is that a good thing? And did New York make a mistake?
So I think it's unclear to me, but it seems that that New York decision came kind of late in the game, and they hadn't done the consensus building that they had done in Virginia. So as a result, the communities around Virginia and in Washington, D.C. are ready and prepared and were bought in. I'm not sure the same thing happened in New York, and that's the reason they've pulled out. But quite honestly, my hope is that they will go to numerous communities, and we were disappointed to think they'd go to New York, where, you know, new startups aren't sort of dying there, okay? They are in different parts of the country. And if they build headquarters or even just a significant office, as many Silicon Valley companies are doing, I was in Indianapolis earlier this week. Salesforce has a huge office there. So we are beginning to see some of these West Coast companies move into the Midwest. My hope is Amazon will do the same.